Welcome back to Today in Rocket Science. I'm Adam Malkin, and we are here in Everglades National Park, the largest mangrove ecosystem in the Western Hemisphere and home to countless species found nowhere else in the world. Preserving this expansive habitat is no easy task, but scientists working within the park work year-round to keep this wetland vibrant. We got a first-hand look at what it takes to keep the park healthy.
You may think, based on sheer size, that nothing we humans do could possibly affect the Everglades. But contrary to the concept that this environment is too huge to harm, this is a fragile ecosystem facing pressure from human development and climate change.
We're in the midst of a 40-year restoration plan. We're trying to fix the Everglades. There's been some tremendous engineering feats to try to replumb the Everglades and send more water to the cities and also to drain the land in South Florida. So now we're trying to undo some of the things that we already did, but we need science behind it.
Major challenges in having the water here in the park where we want to keep it is that just across the way, outside the park boundaries, are where people live, and they don't like it when their house is full of water. We want our plants and our trees and everything to have lots of water. So it's a balance. It's really not an easy one to do.
Damon says water management is also important in protecting this area from sea level rise.
If you basically followed one of the water molecules here all the way down, you would probably end up in Florida Bay and then in the ocean. And as that surface keeps rising, the water keeps creeping in to the Everglades National Park. And that's gonna cause changes. By adding fresh water, we can compete against the rising amount of salt water.
With all this water, it might come as a shock that fire plays a huge part in keeping this wildlife sanctuary thriving. And the National Park Service has a team devoted to not only protecting the park from fires run amok, but actually setting fire within the park to restore the natural order.
The pine rocklands are what we call a fire-dependent ecosystem. Ideally, we'd have a fire occur in this area every 3 to 7 years. If we don't have a fire, those hardwood shrubs will continue to grow and grow and grow and get more dense, and they'll create a lot of shade that shades out this understory.
The team uses special equipment, including a drip torch like this that slowly drips fuel to ignite underbrush. Wildfires happen naturally here in the Everglades, but human development has changed the landscape of South Florida, which can interrupt natural burns.
In the past, if a lightning strike started and ignited a wildfire, that could spread for miles and miles until rain came and put it out. Now we have less opportunity for that because maybe that lightning strike will hit a parking lot instead of a receptive fuel source. And so to kind of help put back some fire where it once naturally occurred, then we'll implement prescribed fires.
Although natural forces continue to dominate here, as human development continues to expand and encroach on the park, these science all-stars are here to lend a helping hand when nature can't keep up.
All right, now if the thought of deliberately setting fire to part of the forest sounds equally fascinating and terrifying, we have a bit of a treat for you now. We're gonna take you for a ride-along on a controlled burn, not here in the Everglades, but rather up north in New York.
Carolyn Wagner has the story from the fire line.
Things definitely got heated at New York's Mohonk Preserve as a team of rangers and ecologists did the opposite of what Smokey Bear says. They started a forest fire.
There you go.
Believe it or not, this blaze is actually helping the forest flourish.
We have some specific species on the preserve that need fire to release their seed. And what happens is when the fire gets to these specific trees, the resin that's in the pine cones, it heats up and expands, and it releases the seed that way.
While many of the trees are already fire resistant, the flames help clear the forest floor and kill off invasive species, making it easier for acorns to take root and grow into the chestnut oaks that are an important part of the preserve. Removing that blanket of leaves and dry limbs serves as a safety measure as well.
We're actually consuming a lot of the fuel, so that's the leaves, the dried brush, the shrubs that start to accumulate in the forest over time. So we're burning those up in a controlled way.
The Nature Conservancy organizes burns like this across the country, often in partnership with other preservation organizations.
A lot of science goes into a prescribed fire: forestry, fire ecology, and also meteorology. Weather conditions are key. A little rain or too much wind can cause all their plans and preparation to go up in smoke.
It's a little bit of a balancing act because it needs to be dry enough to burn, but it can't be so dry that when we go out there and light the fire, that then we have trouble controlling it.
While crews have to undergo a lot of training before they can work on a controlled burn, these events also give them the skills they need to fight dangerous and destructive wildfires, both here in New York and around the country.
Our boss went out to California and did a couple week long trip. So it was pretty cool.
7 or 8 months ago, we had a 3,000-acre wildfire just a few miles down the road from here. It was took about 3 days to put the fire out.
Think you can take the heat? All you need to get involved in this type of work is a background in ecology or environmental sciences and a burning passion for nature. For It Ain't Rocket Science, I'm Tara Lynn Wagner.
Scientists who do this type of work learn valuable lessons about our changing world, which is why some, after years of doing research, decide to bring those lessons to the next generation. In North Carolina, one forensic scientist is doing just that. Lisa Pappas sits in on the lesson.
Calvin Jackson isn't your typical seventh grade science teacher.
A lot of my students will actually say, Mr. Jackson, you've done everything. But it's not that I've done everything, but I have a lot of experience.
Jackson was a federal agent for the Air Force, trained officers in analyzing evidence, and spent 20 years as a criminal forensics professor at a community college. He says it was a lot of behind-the-scenes work.
Normally in a laboratory someplace, testifying on a court someplace, teaching crime scene investigators.
But after all that, he decided to switch careers and head to the classroom.
I personally love science, but if you don't like science, he makes it a lot easier to learn because he's fun.
Jackson's students love his class since every day they do hands-on experiments like building their own barometers or anemometers.
It takes the wind speed and it calculates it by it turning.
Taking lessons into their own hands to learn about the weather.
I like the saying, teach me and I learn, but then there's involve me and I understand.
And that's exactly what Jackson hopes to continue for students in the future. He already started a forensics club at the school and hopes to expand it to a camp and then an actual class.
At some point, we're hoping to be able to write a curriculum in forensics for middle school.
Using his own experience to inspire students to explore science in new ways. For It Ain't Rocket Science, I'm Litza Pappas.
All right, let's stop now for one more quick break. Then, coming up,
we continue our journey here in Everglades National Park as we follow a group of young conservationists in the making as they venture into the heart of the wilderness. And it's far from Florida's untamed wilderness, but we'll hear how one engineer is bringing some of the world's wildest places to your doorstep, developing expansive habitats for the Columbus Zoo and Aquarium. To find hands-on science, technology, engineering, and math opportunities in your community, visit theconnectory.org, made possible by Time Warner Cable's Connect a Million Minds.